Thank you for having me. I have never been to Savannah, but I love places with history. I'm from Los Angeles, so if it's even from the 50s, we think it's old. I wanted to just give a special thanks to Judith Crawford and Gail Lawrence for inviting me, and Linda Rollet and her daughter Sarah Rollet, and the Telfair Academy Guild, as well as the Telfair Museum, because it was an invitation, and I'm grateful to be here. I've only been here for 48 hours or so, so I wanted to just squeeze in everything that would be Savannah. I got a really great little tour from John Deering, and we went and saw some properties and some of the older homes here. And he was a hoot. Are you here, John? Oh, he had enough of me, see? He's like, that was enough for me. So I had a great time. I went to the Pink House for dinner. I cornered some people for ghost stories. I went to Elizabeth's last night. So in just a very short period of time, because I'm leaving today, I got to see, I think, some of the best things in Savannah. I went running yesterday morning around Forsyth Park, and I thought, this is out of time. I mean, it really is so unusual to visit a city. There really aren't very many cities like this in America. That's just preserved so well. The only other city like this that I visited was Charleston, and they both have such beautiful architecture. So it's really my pleasure to be here and indulge myself in all this beauty. I wanted to just tell you just a little bit about myself. I really love all creative things. I'm not just interiors. In fact, I'm one of those people that's still thinking, like, what should I do next? Maybe I'll go be one of those cake decorator people, like those famous, that Sylvia Weinstock. I always want to do something new and different. I initially started out in fashion. I studied fashion at Parsons in New York after I went to Boston University. And I somehow fell into interiors. I had my own business. I was a milliner and accessories designer. Fashion's really my first love. But I'd always loved interiors. But I didn't really intend to be an interior designer initially. I just always loved it. It just was another creative outlet, as probably lots of creative people here know. You know, when you're interested in one thing, then you're interested in another. You just might not want to do it as a business. Because as you know, once you start to do something as a business, it's not as fun. So, someone asked me to decorate their house. It was it still exists. It's Robert Clergerie. They made shoes and bags, and she was their PR person. And she moved to Los Angeles and had this beautiful penthouse in this 1920s building. That's very old for us there. But it was very glamorous. It was a penthouse in sort of this old Hollywood area where originally Hollywood, you know, stars lived. And I did it just because she had asked me, because I cared about my apartment. I cared about my dorm room when I was young, although I intended to go into fashion. I remember my first dorm room, which was horrible. It was around a football field at Boston University, and so I had it with a roommate, and I remember my half of the room was very 80s, and it was like mid-80s, so it was black and white and red, and I had two Steinberg posters. It was kind of corny, but it was done, you know? And I was only 17, so I actually really always had I just always cared about space in tandem with fashion and jewelry and accessories. Excuse me. So that's how I started designing homes. And it just, people would ask me. And I think in 2000, someone else, a friend of mine, a big production designer for movies, submitted my house to House and Garden. He said, they're asking me for houses. And it didn't really dawn on me. I was just doing it as a business, but I hadn't really had a focus that I should be getting published and I should be doing these things. I was sort of letting it come how it came. So they took my house and they put it on the cover, and then it really sort of grew right from there. Because that gave me sort of a public following where people would be, oh, you did this or you did that. And funny thing is, I've had some jobs that I've done for people that they might be huge jobs, and it's really more their taste than mine. But the first job I did, I just found the pictures of, and I wished I'd put it in my first book, because it actually, you know, I could do what I wanted. She didn't know. She said, would you just do it? And I actually, it was not bad at all, and it's better than some of my bigger jobs where the people would just not let me do what I needed to do. So if there's anyone out there that's frustrated as a designer, this happens to all of us. So what I'm going to talk about is just the fun part, that I like to do so many different styles of work that I don't think people would actually even realize. So there's things in that I'm going to show through our slideshow that aren't in my book that are totally different than perhaps this cover, because I'm asked all the time to do things. Wait, isn't there a clicker here? Oh, is it this or is that a pen? Okay. Well, let's see what the pen does. I'm asked to do all these crazy things. Everyone, maybe not here, but coast to coast, so many people want their house to look like a club now, like a, you know, like a cool, hip 70s club. So I'm going to start with one of the looks that, and it's fun for me because it's like doing, it's like being a production designer for someone's life. I sort of pick who they think they want to be. They kind of tell me who they think they want to be, and then I think, like, well, that's not really who you really are. So let me make, you know, it's like a fight between a director and an actor, and they don't know what's happening, and then, you know, we all want to direct. So let's see, my first group, where are we? Wait. It's talking to me. Yes. Am I doing this wrong?
Wait a minute, Brandon's coming.
It's pointing.
Yeah, it's pointing. There we go.
Oh, okay. Maybe I'm doing this sort of, okay. Well, this is a little bit like a weird doctor tool. I'm gonna drop that subject. Okay, Maud. These are the clubs. This is what's sort of the most current Maud. So for my first picture here, this is a store in New York City named Monica Chang. I actually did this on the TV show, the Million Dollar Decorator TV show. But, you know, they squash it down because you have 5 minutes to show this and 5 minutes to show that. And it's not really the long process that it is, because that's also boring. So they really just hope they get a fight and something broken and then someone getting kicked out. And they kind of encourage you to give that to them if they can't get it. And since you want to leave too, you're willing to almost get in a fight so that you can just get out and they can stop rolling the cameras and you can get the job done. So the parameters of what I had to work with here, it had a great space. It was in Soho. She wanted some color. She wanted this to feel like it really was a kind of a cool, like Bianca Jagger's bedroom. But I couldn't do tons of color because every season your clothes change. So she was willing to have this emerald green be sort of a staple of a pop of color. But as a neutral, we chose lavender. So you can see that the walls are all done in a raffia paper that's really pretty lavender. The second room behind that is all done in portiere drapes, so it really feels sort of like a retro bedroom, boudoir, you know, dressing room. But then at the same time, we've got all these references to other eras. We've got a 50s Janssen table, 60s lighting fixtures. So pulling from different mid-century periods tends to read as Maud in my little formula when I'm trying to achieve this. But we used multiple different materials and textures. We've got ebonized wood. I had the walls faux painted on the right in these niches to be malachite pattern, but it was in lavender. And lavender actually is a very easy to use neutral. It sort of works like gray, but it's still a color, so it's a little more fun. This is a close-up of one of the back rooms, and then on the right you'll see that they're very 60s inspired custom brass fixtures with the malachite inset with the textured raffia, and then the velvet stools sitting in front of the clothes. They have a faux bois velvet pattern on them. So everything had a lot of texture, but we chose from different periods of furnishings. And we, on purpose, threw in things that were kind of from the 60s and 70s a little. So you could kind of see how Bianca Jagger would think this place was very cool, and yet it was womanly and inviting. Okay, this is a groovy bedroom from, believe it or not, this is a beach house, but this is on the West Coast. And this is Ryan Murphy's, one of his beach houses. He's the creator of Glee, American Horror Story, that new crazy show with all the girls that are brats with the purses. Do you know what I'm talking about? Water if I need it. Oh, Water if I need it. I thought she was telling me that was the name of the show. I was like, it's not Water if I need it. Scream Queens. All these crazy shows. So you can imagine how poverty-stricken he is at this point. Anyway, he said to me, he goes, I want it to be like Tom Ford, who was the head designer of Gucci for years. But he meets Ralph Lauren, and he's very smart and kind of weird and cynical, as you could see, because who comes up with all those weird murderous stories? So I had to pull from different eras. Once again, this is why I'm calling it mod. I have mid-century mirrors. We upholstered the walls in a blue linen. The ceiling is all done in Maya Romanoff brass tiles that are patterned. He needed it to be a little bit rock and roll, but at the same time, we used tonalities and textiles that would definitely be seen in a Ralph Lauren home. The velvet, cut velvet drapery, the brown linen, the brown and the navy, it's all very Ralph, but if you look at it, it's very Ralph gone disco. And you'll see that we also have these barrel chairs that are from the 70s, which is very Tom Ford. So people want this, I'm finding in interiors this eclectic mix of things that you just have to be really careful with your textiles and your tonalities to be able to tie it together, because it can very easily look like a junk store. You have to at least visually make it soothing. So we just stuck with navies and browns and chocolates, so it was masculine. And you'll see there's a 19th century marble top pedestal table there. So, you know, it's like Ralph and Tom got together and had a couple cocktails, and they kept having cocktails. But I kind of like it because it's weird. And if you see out through the window, that is the water. Those are cliffs that go to the water when you kill yourself because you realize, what have I done here? It's super crazy. This is the same person's house, and my requirement here was I had to make this was a concrete hallway. The floor was concrete, the walls were concrete. The whole thing was just a concrete hallway on the way to the garage. It had a little window where you see to the left of right here, where you see this is the window. I just discovered my little laser pointer. This is so. And he needed an office for when he was down there. He always had an assistant that was running his life. And it was a very long, thin space, but it was big enough to make an office. So we did this custom ceruzed oak desk with these custom bronze legs that were done by an artist. If you'll see, they're all ribbed. I'm forgetting the name of this process. So who cares? Let's move on from that. So everything I had to make this warm, I made sure everything had a texture. The ceiling's done in cork that has a little metallic coming through the back of it. The skylight has a linen shade. The walls are raffia. The floor has a custom stark patterned rug. Everything had a nice, deep, rich texture just to warm this up. And actually, it was pretty successful considering this was a hallway that looked like it was on the way to a garage. Here's modern. So now modern to me isn't necessarily mod. It doesn't have to be totally hip and groovy, but it's usually clean lines. some of the pieces of furniture, they're generally Knoll or Cartel. There's something of a certain period where things were clean and linear, and you're just sort of playing offline. I do like to use a little bit of pattern, even in modern. So I tried to pick from the Madeline Wine Rib rug to the David Hicks pattern. They really sort of just played off of each other, but I mimic the straight lines by doing a custom horizontal drape in gray, white, and black. And the room is only gray, white, and black. This was a family room for a television executive, and she has children. So those little antique chairs, I do like to throw in some things that have sort of a little bit of history, just a little bit of hand to them, and age, even in a modern, completely linear space. There's a TV above the fireplace. So this was really where they go in and watch TV. But I tried not to make it too busy. So sometimes I'll just start with a little formula of what, you know, first I'll start with the furniture plan because I don't know how I'm gonna use this clean palette, like color palette, if I don't know what it's going on. Sometimes you want a room all red, but if you don't have anything to put the red on, you're just dealing with walls. It's not that successful. So I really just tried to play off a square, rectangular furniture plan and the straight lines, which I repeated in the horizontal drapery. This is a little niche in a hotel I did years ago called the Lux Bel Air. And the thing about this is that I was forced to keep these two niches for some sort of soffit. I needed to keep this as it was, and we didn't want to lose any space. So sometimes you're given something that's sort of horrible, and you'll find that you can actually make it seem like it was something custom. So I actually kept these niches and cut them this certain way, where this is in a bar on the side of, you'll see here's the bar stools. So I kept the niches to give it just a little bit of depth and visual relief, and I used them. So I put the banquettes in them, and once again, for things that are very modern to me, I like to keep a lot of straight lines, right angles, and I tend to just keep the colors very minimal. I don't really like to use a lot of pattern. Being a hotel, you really do need to have a pattern somewhere on the ground because of the dirt. It's sort of a technical thing. That's why when you go in hotels, sometimes you can't believe how horrible the floors are, because you don't know why there's so many different patterns everywhere, but that's something they do so that they can get 10 years of wear out of the carpet. The more busy things are, the less that you'll see any kind of dirt going on. So I had to have a pattern on the ground, but I really just used right angles. But I tried to make it seem a little bit more like a home. I put an antique here. These are antique Chinese pedestals. And I only used brown and taupe and light pink. And actually, last night, your window was a little, it's taupe and pink. I've always loved a little taupe and chocolate and pink. So we had these modern paintings commissioned that were all based on sort of straight lines. I call them my Neapolitan ice cream paintings. And the funny thing is the girl that worked for me at the time, she'd gone to UCLA, she'd gone to art school, and we were so low on the budget that she said, I'll make them and I won't charge you very much. And now she's this world famous DJ named Mia Moretti. And I sold them. I didn't sell these, but I sold her other art on One King's Lane as Mia Moretti's, but really she was just my old assistant that was off in a corner. So it makes me laugh. Anyway, my formula here is generally just playing off of nice, clean, straight lines, and then a simple, clean color palette with just a pop of color. This was a pop of pink with a couple personal items so that it doesn't seem so cool. This is a movie producer's house. Actually, this woman, she wants to be hip and cool, like everybody wants to be hip and cool is what I'm coming across. But she has this beautiful Georgian house in Los Angeles. She actually is the producer of Frida, that movie Frida, about Frida Kahlo. She loves to play poker, and she plays poker with all these Hollywood heavy hitters, so this whole room had to go around this poker table in the back, which, I mean, it's kind kind of hard. It's not like poker tables are that attractive. So we went shopping for mid-century pieces. We have the mid-century chairs here, the mid-century fixture. And once again, I kept this very clean. This is a Mansour custom rug. I did like this little bit of a pattern in it. It reminded me of a backgammon set, and I love that pattern so much so that I used it in my last Schumacher collection as an inspiration. But if you'll notice, there's not a lot of pattern here, and I find that that keeps things more contemporary when that's my goal. There's just a little spot of color on this mid-century chair, the teal, and the tealy blue here. And then I like to work with, while I'm working with sort of straight lines, clean palette, you know, I'll throw something in that has a little bit of an interesting silhouette to it, such as these or this fixture. This is one of her best friends, kind of fun, funky, modern art piece. And it actually is the famous songwriter Carol Bayer Sager, who's much more famous for being a songwriter. She was married to Burt Bacharach, and she's probably written most of the old love songs that you have heard. Well, now she's an artist, and she's actually really good, which this is very modern and clean. But that was my one requirement, that I had to use the peanuts. It's kind of better in person because it looks like a photograph there, but it's fun and funky. Next. Oh, Bohemian Lux. Okay, well, this is something that's more fun for me to do, because if anyone's like a slight hoarder, this is really how you can use everything that you had to have, because I have storage. And this is something that people ask me to do that usually have Mediterranean houses or Italianate houses. Oh, I didn't mean to do that. Can I go back? Okay. Bohemian Lux is sort of, to me, it's an interior that looks like you've traveled the world and you brought this back from somewhere, you know, you took the world tour and you went to India and then you went over to Australia and then you went all through Europe. So it's more fun, because if you like to buy things, and you have sort of a vision for this kind of thing. It's actually, you can really sink your teeth into collections and making collections for people. So my goal here, I just had a big, huge white room. It was the original fireplace. This was a 1920s a sort of rambling estate up Benedict Canyon in Beverly Hills, but it had been defunct for years and years. So it was remodeled. It actually was one of the Lucky Brand jeans owners. And they wanted it friendly, you know, cool and friendly, but at the same time it had to look luxurious and not too dirty, grungy. But so Bohemian Lux to me is really sort of a lie. It's usually something that looks like you've traveled the world, but there's really nothing bohemian about it, because it's not for poor people. It's someone that has been able to travel the entire world in whatever the way they chose. And so it's not really bohemian. It's really fohemian. So what I did here to make this cohesive, because if you'll notice all over, there's a Moroccan table, there's Indian chairs, there's gilded French chairs. This was bought in Paris, and it's a bone inlaid 19th century cabinet, Italian gilded consoles. It's really a total mix of continental and sort of ethnic antiques, a paisley. But the thing that makes this casual to me and more clean and now and a little more youthful is I just did the entire floor in a seagrass rug. So using a natural fiber on the ground for me makes things lighter and friendlier and not so old school formal, and makes it more of a current contemporary light application or vision. But I did keep everything red. And if you notice, if everything was a bunch of different patterns, it probably wouldn't look as cohesive. So there's something soothing about what you do with color and how the ratios you use color and the ratios you use pattern that might tie a room together that might otherwise not be tied together at all. You could, if you put everything in this room in white, it would be tied together as well, but it would also read much more summery, and it would be very pretty. It just would be a very different room. We kept, and these Indian mirrors, I just made sure I had a smattering of absolutely everything, but you're talking to someone who has storage, and like, there's really nothing I ever want to get rid of. So this is one of the most fun things for me to do, if they let me do it, really. This is a close-up of the sofa. Oh, so I had to search all over for these Suzanis because I wanted, these are the antique Suzanis. I wanted them only in black and red, but like a pinky red, which I couldn't really find anywhere. So I got online, I had my office get online on eBay, literally eBay. I mean, you can get things on eBay if you want to sit and put a collection together. And we ordered them from, I think, Uzbekistan. Like, what was that movie? What was that movie? That crazy guy, Borat. And they came. Here's the thing. I'm really a diehard for style, and I'm not a stickler for some other things. So they came out of the box, and I have to say they were so stinky. I don't even know if they were put in like a cow barn or... I used them anyway. And we aired them out. I took them to the cleaners, but they were still really stinky. And they came in on presentation, they're like, what smells? And I was like, I don't know, because they looked so good. They looked so good. I mean, I spent hours and hours and hours looking these Suzanis up to get the right color, because then someone would have something where it would be something yellow in it or purple, but it would be red and black. So really, the picture is fantastic because you can't smell it. They actually made me get rid of them because they were so stinky, but this one wasn't so stinky. Anyway, this is a little corner of the room. I had these custom sort of tree of life pattern watercolors done, and they were kind of a complementary pair. One was on the other side of the room, and this was on the other. And we just pulled all of the colors of the room. It was very important to me to keep the walls super white so that it was light and airy and Californian. I was thinking of it as sort of an Andalusian fantasy. So if we just had red absolutely everywhere, and even in the art here, and she made it where they look like, they were so beautiful. They look like old panels that were collected, but I couldn't find what I wanted, so I had to commission it at the time. So, and there, and then we matched it with little red apples. All this little junk is so, ties these things together, especially if you're about to entertain. This is an old library of mine. This is part of Bohemian Lux. You'll see it's sort of luxury, but at the same time, it's a bit of a mess, which is why I call it Bohemian luxury or Fohemian luxury. You'll see the original library was in this stained oak, and it was very sort of dark, but at the same time, this was a estate that was designed by an architect named Elmer Gray, who also designed the Beverly Hills Hotel and quite a few other things that were at the turn of the century in California. And so I didn't really, this house was not ruined. It wasn't one of those things that in Los Angeles, they literally will just tear down something, like they would tear this church down. They'd be like, well, that, it's, you know, it's old. And so it's, you know, it takes, it's really sad. So I wanted to actually keep these references to the original house. So I did it all in beautiful mossy greens that would be very typical in an English house, and this was an English Tudor style house. But to zip it up a little, I did a animal skin rug, and as you'll see again, I have little things of collected other parts of the world, Indian chairs, old antique vintage tortoise shells, and I have some other shells that are outside the picture. a little bit collected from all over the place. But it doesn't read stiff and formal. It reads as a room that you would really actually go in, plop down, grab a book, in that kind of kick your shoes off. Things are a little bit collected all over. And then, so it wasn't so dull. I did the ceiling in a lacquer chartreuse green, and I did the matching shades so that your eye wasn't darting all over the place. But at the same time, there was a couple little fun, hip elements to a space that when I walked in on, it was like, it was a little bit old lady. This is the, was that funny? I'm like, wait, what was funny? Oh, the old lady. It was a little old lady. In fact, now that I look at it, it's still a little old lady. Let's keep going. But I also like old lady. I should have a whole section called old lady because I actually like old lady too. There's not a lot I don't like. Oh, good. I knew I was home. Well, that's not totally true. So this is a dining room of the that is in the other house that I showed you that had the red living room. And I just wanted to show that we decided to stain the entry all the oak, this ebony dramatic color. And it was very dark and dramatic. And we repeated these, we repeated this Moorish shape throughout the house. We had redone the house, so we found this doorway somewhere in the house and we repeated it. To just see that black, to go into that sort of light dining room. Oh, look what I did. I got onto my emails or something. Oh, I don't know what I did here. Let's see if I can get out of this. Anybody a tech whiz? Talk around that. What did I do? Oh, look at that. A mouse. Did I just lean on that? Okay. Sorry, hold on. Wait. Thank you. I'm going to take this off. I'm a little hot. Fine. There.
I woke up with this.
Right. So, remember, this is a room that has to tie into the same feeling as that red living room. So you can see how this would relate to the same vibe of the living room, even if it's not the same color scheme, which had an Anglo-Indian base of furniture. So let's look at the next photo. So when we get in, you'll see I repeated the seagrass on the floor so that all the floors were stained of really dark ebony, which is actually very dark when it's everywhere and you don't have rugs. It's kind of more New York apartment, lofty, dramatic, but it makes things very heavy. And the woodwork, and most of the woodwork in this house was stained a dark ebony. The client liked that white-black contrast, which it can be so harsh. So you'll notice that I used a varying assortment of furniture. I used Anglo-Indian chairs that had cane backs. We put cushions on them, the English dining table. And actually, just to warm this up, I did a burlap-covered end console table, just with trim and some custom passementry on the end. And this is before I did my Schumacher line, and this is where I came up with, I would make these custom passementry, this was more like frogs that closed the table, because I would see it done in very Italian or European homes over, you know, different decades. And I loved doing it, but it was so expensive. So on my first Schumacher line, on my trims, we did sort of easy to use little versions of them. So it was like pre-done trim that you could use as frogs or corner joints, you know, different accessories, because people weren't doing it. So I really just played off of ebony, different ebony stains, blue, I repeated the blue, with little spots of red, which made it friendly, and I repeated throughout the house blue and whites, because it gives you sort of a traveled, fresh, and it's friendly. Blue and white's always very friendly. And I loved putting these palms in the end of the dining room, right here. You'll see the palm. I think it adds a bit of life. All the room was done in a blue, very pretty, oceany blue raffia paper. And I just repeated that throughout. There's a Portuguese-inspired sideboard here with a little bit of the cane. So I'm picking these little items that I put in a basket when I'm trying to have this sort of bohemian luxury look. And then it never hurts to have a Persian carpet for warmth and sort of a timeless effect. This is a show house I did for House Beautiful. I probably did it 10 years ago, but it was the same sort of formula. I'm using traditional elements that have a European flavor. I have to say this is the way we upholstered this sofa at the end of the bed, all in Ralph Lauren fabrics, but with this batiky Indian flavor, blue and white, striped down the center of the sofa. It's really not something that's very American. It's more of an Italian or English thing that people will do with upholstery. So I wanted to have these little nods to European design over the past century. I based this room on these custom-made cornice pelmets that we did. I had a person that does shell mirrors and shell, all sorts of shell things, custom make these all in the same colors of the room. So I remember at the time Ralph Lauren had given me all the fabric to do the room. And the funny thing is, with the show house, because they were publishing the show house, the project director for this particular show house, it was in, I think, Bel Air. Oh no, this one was actually in Brentwood, but what's the difference? What's the difference? It's all LA to you. He told me, before we moved anything in and you first paint your room, it was very bright orange. But I did that intentionally to not make this room. Imagine if this was just a blue. I think it would be so, it wouldn't be fresh, it wouldn't be young, it would just be pretty and old and traditional. So I had the walls painted a very bright orange, knowing I was using orange accessories, and it's such a pretty foil to blue. And at the time, Leontine Linens had given me these beautiful, beautiful linens here, and with this orange sort of fretwork on them. And so the guy that was running the show house, he came up to me. Now keep in mind, they're show houses, so I'm paying for the whole thing myself unless someone's donating it. And he said, we don't think that you can have the room this orange. It's just not right. And so he said, please tone it down. Sorry, I'm too close to this or something. Please tone it down. Please tone it down. And I thought, okay, I'll have them come back in and paint the room again. So I just had them come back in and paint the room the same color again. I did. I mean, the first coat looked really electric, strange. It did. Even I was like, okay, this is a little too bright. But I just kept coming in to paint it down and paint it down. He got so tired anyway that he moved on to someone else. Here's the funny thing. So once, I knew that it was bright because it was supposed to have a tension between everything I was putting in there because everything was so traditional that I wanted a tension. I wanted it to be like they were both fighting each, or not fighting, but pulling against each other so that I brought it up. So it didn't seem like you actually came into a 19th century room that just had everything was sort of old in it and dust on it. So the funny thing is, did we take that picture out? Oh, we did. Oh, well, to the left of this is the side table with these big blue lamps and two blue and whites under it, and they put it on the cover. So, I laugh about that. Now, there's things like that that have happened, and it never made it on the cover, and I never saw it again. So, this next picture is a library in that old
sort of Casa California estate, and it had all these pretty shelves in it, but they had been stained dark, and it was kind of too much of a repetition of dark and dark and dark and dark. So we had had them stripped, and actually part of them were oak and part of them weren't. So this room, the entire goal was for it to feel layered in sandy, beachy colors. So I had to take every opportunity I could to find things that really had a depth to them. So everything in the shelf has a bit of a hand to it. From the antique, there's antique urns up here, there's woven baskets. You know, when you're dealing in just neutrals, which is also fun, you just have to make sure there's a lot of texture going on with each thing to do tone on tone on tone of a neutral. And we had all of the bookcases, we had them ceroused where they were oak and faux painted where they weren't, so that it had this really grainy, rich driftwoody quality where you could see where it looked white and a little bit black and a little bit gray, you know, up close and in person. And all the fabrics were, this was a Belgian linen that was very nubby. So in person, everything had a bit of a woven quality. And once again, to lighten up the floors, I did a custom natural fiber rug. But this time I chose a pattern just because I'm trying to get pattern on pattern on pattern. And all those things are inspirational to me. Like, they've inspired me for my latest Schumacher collection. I'm not for sale, but this does show you where my backgammon, this sort of love of this pattern of backgammon, I've been wanting to use for years. And this is my latest collection's kind of got an ethnic, islandy quality, and we did it once again with the trim. But I'm just tying in a little bit of product throughout this whole lecture to show you little things inspire me, and then they end up in a product, or they might end up in some new type of room I want to do. But all these little things weave through. You know, funny thing is, here for our photo shoot, we took the trim and we put it on my outfit. So everything really, like, that is, the trim is actually, that's one of my trims, and that's one of my trims. You know, I actually love fashion. All these things kind of dovetail together. If you want to dress like your room and be a super weirdo. I was just talking to someone last night about wanting to do the Natchez pilgrimage, and that you get to dress up in your house from some other period in time where you could really tie your whole room together. You could really actually wear your curtains. And I'd probably be the first person to do it. So these are some of my last collection that just came out over the summer. Just showing you that I like things that are traditional and chinoiserie, but at the same time, I like this whole islandy feeling. Like, I've taken this backgammon design, and you can use it in multiple different ways. And we did this custom batiki pattern on raffia. I'm inspired by so many different things, and I love different things. I just don't like them all at once. It's like, I don't want to wear an evening outfit and high top sneakers. I could probably wear high top sneakers, but I definitely need a leather jacket and some jeans. This is my love of detail here. This was one of our custom fabrics that have this islandy flavor that could be used in any of these Mediterranean or beachy type homes or islandy homes. But my love of fashion is really evident here. This is a very wide, wide, wide trim. And all of this is hand-done raffia that's all been hand-woven. This is wood beads. This is another wood bead, and I was inspired by this particular trim, and then we have a long linen, all linen fringe. I wanted it to feel like it really was an island, and if you were really stuck on an island in a real faux-hemian way with lots of people making things for you, which would mean you weren't really stuck on the island, you would be able to make your whole room look like it was Mrs. Howell. In fact, one of my wallpapers is called Mrs. Howell. You know, didn't you always wonder on Gilligan's Island, like, how come her hut's all decorated? I did. And where does she get that coral lipstick?
I mean, it didn't last 10 years, that old stick of lipstick.
Oh, and here's a close-up of my pillows. This is just my latest Islandy collection. Just showing kind of my love of fashion and how I apply it to interiors. This is the same. This is a different trim, but you'll see it's all hand-done beading and hand-done fringe that's all linen with the stripe on it. It's very fashion-y, but it's very specific to this particular look of this collection. And originally, for this collection, I was inspired by Yves Saint Laurent has this period of dresses that were called Les Afriques, and you can Google it online. And it is all these models from sometime in the 70s with these little skimpy dresses on that are only beads. It's beads here, it's a different kind of bead here, it goes to fringe. It looked like a custom African, all the craftsmen and that you would find in Africa over centuries, with all this beading and fabulous work. If you look it up, it's very dramatic. It was on display at the Met when there was an exhibit. But those little things can inspire me to, you know, have trim and things that end up in interiors that you would never even put together. Glamour. Everyone likes a little bit of glamour. So now this is a very modern type of glamour, but this is one of my bedrooms historically. I don't have this bedroom now, but I find when I want things to be a little bit of glamorous, I tend to use a little bit of gilding, like this sort of Regence settee that's all 22 karat gilded with these brass mid-century sort of Maison Janssen style legs, which I actually bought this. I didn't buy this as an ottoman. I bought this, it was some really ugly, weird bench with a horrible top at an auction because I couldn't help myself. But I liked the legs, and I must have kept it in storage so long, not knowing what to do with it, because I have a 2,000 square foot storage space for things that I can't even get to anymore, so I don't know what's in the back of it. So I took that and I made sort of a glamorous square tufted ottoman, which was more of a nod to sort of mid-century as opposed to a Victorian. I have this little blue astrakhan type throw that I've done on the end of this sort of modern version of maybe a Duchess Brisée. It's a little chinoiserie custom chair with a long ottoman, so you can either use it as a chaise or not. But I find this is my sort of simple modern formula mixed with a little bit of glamour. My modern formula of just using very clean color palette, navy and white with a spot of hot pink, but one pattern. And I painted the seagrass floor here. It's seagrass. This was in California, but I wanted something sort of modern, and I didn't want a rug, and it was there. So I hired someone to come in and do sort of a David Hicks style, very simple, clean, but overscaled. I like to do overscaled floor patterns, just because it makes it a little bit more modern and contemporary. So even if you had a totally traditional space and a very clean, modern floor, it's geometric, but it was upscaled, bigger than little teeny squares, it would make a place much more contemporary, and probably just give you that edge that you would need. And then I used my lamp this is my original lamp that I ended up reproducing for Robert Abbey, which is based on tradition. It was an urn with brass collar, brass base, with gilded stripes in it. And this is the other side of the room. This is where it's all these little things that were very feminine and glamorous. I hung this 18th century mirror on these, God, what is wrong with me? You know, yes, God, thank you. The medallions, with a little bit of a chain. I love Malmaison. How many people have been to Malmaison outside Paris? Four? Come on. You have to go now, like get on a plane.
It is so pretty. Every Southerner would love it. It is decorated. It's Napoleon and Josephine's country house, and Josephine had it done how she wanted, and it's totally decorated like it was. They restored everything. It's faux painted. It's got directoire libraries. It is so fabulous, but it doesn't look anything like this, so why am I talking about it? Because these little chains up here, things were hung on chains all over. And then another thing that adds a little bit of glamour is just to use your millwork. I painted this, my millwork, a dark shade with the white trim, because it gave it this pop, this sort of French 40s pop. And then I used the gilded mid-century rope vanity with the 19th century boudoir chair. So just little bits of gold with a very clean color palette, using different decades of furniture, tends to add, oh, look, it's a Mia Moretti original. I think that is literally the one I sold on One Kings Lane. And they loved it. Okay, so this is a very, this is glamorous, but it's sort of mod and at the same time a little bit edgy and weird. I just finished this project the past year. This is the same woman who lives in Bel Air and has this beautiful view of the city. This is all Los Angeles that you can see on a promontory. And her one requirement was that she had certain art in her house that was what I had to work with, and this had to be, on the left here, she had this Toulouse-Lautrec oil painting, and it's a beautiful museum-quality painting, and yet she wanted things modern and traditional. So what I did is I started with this painting not wanting to compete with it or fight with it, and yet not wanting to just match it where it was overpowered. So I started with that, and we went to Doris Leslie Blau in New York, and we did this sort of Art Nouveau rug. And she had seen this kooky table, which is actually beautifully made out of Paris by Paul Mathieu. He's an artist that's represented by Pucci in New York. And we had this custom table made, and I'm gonna go back. And you'll see, because this table is not movable, it does not have leaves, all the top is shagreen, and it was shipped from Paris, and it took about a year to make. It is so enormously weighty, you couldn't possibly move it. She does have more chairs that she can have a huge dinner party, but if she's having three or four people over just for a little dinner, we made use of this bay window, and we did a little custom oval table that the artist made, and it's oval so that you could get quite a few chairs around it when you want to have an intimate dinner over here. This is actually a beautiful Georgian house, but she's more of an edgy type person that wanted to have references to some of these mid-century pieces, such as the disc chandeliers here, and yet we have somewhat of a neoclassical dining chair with the column out of New York from Roman Thomas. So my goal was to soothingly display the Toulouse-Lautrec art and yet at the same time give her all her edginess that she wanted, and she wanted this antique wallpaper. So you can imagine all the things that I can ask for. I want bobbly earrings, and I want to wear sneakers, and I want a red leather jacket, and. So I have to find a way to say, why don't we put all that in this other room and just try these three things? I try not to say no. I just say, that is a great idea. Why don't we table that, and let's just go over here. So this was all I could whittle this down to. Well, this is a very glamorous entry. Mainly, it was glamorous with nothing in it because it's a two-story entry of the house that Elmer Gray. Sorry, I was about to say Elmer Fudd, okay? I was like, wait, who's Elmer Fudd? Elmer Gray, the architect of also the Beverly Hills Hotel, designed this house in the 20s, and these are the original limestone Gothic arches. The floor
was actually just a plain wood floor because they probably would have had rugs on it. And we were debating tearing it out and doing kind of a crazy mod, some sort of honed marble floor. But before we did that, I thought, why don't we just try something fun and young and painted? You can't really see in this picture because it's so dark, but all of the staircase is all carved, very ornately carved, and it comes all the way down and around this way. But you can see back here that it's a red oak interior, but it was stained super dark. It was very heavy in sort of a Ralph Lauren mansion kind of way, but it was almost too heavy. So we had it stained and bleached. I didn't want to have it done white where it looked like a beach house. I still wanted to have a reference to an old stately home. But I wanted, once again, something that was sort of young and current. So I drove someone absolutely crazy trying to do the math of this thing going around here, because it had to literally be a certain distance here and a certain distance here, which I know all sounds fine until you go to put little circles in the whole thing. They were mad at me because they had to redo it 10 times. But I think it actually, I actually was inspired by this design from a castle in England where it's all done in stone. And I don't know why it's blanking on me. It's a very famous castle. In fact, if you ever see it, you will think that must be what it is. And it's this oval shape pattern with the extensions on all four sides. And once again, I just used the same vibrant color of persimmon so that It actually really popped, but it wasn't busy. And this is a 6 foot tall chandelier, so you can get an idea of the scale of the room. I used to call this room the lobby, although it's the entry, because no one really knew what to do with it and no one needed to do anything in it. So we would just go, why don't you go to the lobby? And we would kind of laugh about it because it kind of is sort of a lobby of a European hotel that isn't huge. This is an old living room of mine that it was dark wood that I didn't want to paint it white where it looks like a brand new spec house. That's all over like the Hamptons and Los Angeles. There's beautiful homes, but they're all painted. All the woodwork is all painted white, which is very pretty, but it doesn't, you can't see any age to it. But at the same time, when you have an all wood room that is a living room, it can be very dark. So right off the bat, I thought, what color can compete with dark wood and not make it darker? And I thought really bright canary Chinese yellow. So to lighten this room, I just used a natural, very almost ivory fiber area rug, which lightens the whole space up, than looking at a dark floor. I used all ivory, and as you can see, I love all different periods of furniture, and this is basically a traditional interior. English chairs, French Louis XVI chairs, English gilded stools, mid-century brass tables, English gilded consoles, mid-century chinoiserie screen. This is actually a mix of something that's just very pretty and traditional, yet I think the lack of multiple patterns makes it cleaner, fresher, younger, more now. And I think the yellow actually enlivened the dark wood. Oh, this is an old closet of mine. Of course, I'm showing things that are mine because I like them best, because I was my own best client, because I just said yes to myself. I didn't have to fight myself on what I was presenting to myself, and I didn't have to make boards, which is so much better. This was an office that was next to a bedroom. It was not the best use of space, but what I really wanted was a place to lounge around and feel like I could sit and talk on the phone. And I was in Bergdorf's shoe department doing nothing. So I ate the entire middle section of the closet up, which I really actually desperately needed, and had to put the closet has two halves that are this deep. So this first half that you don't see, I had doors on everything, but it actually made it so sort of hard to get to different things. I just took them off and I think it's really pretty. If you can keep your closet neat, it's pretty. I had all the purses on hooks up here so that I didn't waste an ounce of space. But what I wanted here was a really pretty aqua blue. Blue is so soothing, like all shades of blue. But I didn't want it super dull. So I chose this Osborne and Little, really kind of cool now wallpaper, which is now probably yesterday, since now was then and then is over. But I love these colors. I still love these colors. I bought these chairs in Paris with Nathan Turner. He goes, "Mums, these are so you." You can see it has a little like chinoiserie guy with a little, you know, like umbrella type thing on him. And I dragged them home because they're literally chocolate brown and light pink Aubusson upholstered antique chairs, which was like very unusual. So I had to have those. I still love those. Although I have nowhere to put them right now, so they're in storage. I think what is important here is the waste of space. I loved it. I would lay on the phone here, but actually, seriously, I find is important here is actually the tension between things that are very modern, a lacquered blue ceiling, and things that are very sort of historical. This sofa is more of a 70s style sofa with silver studs on it, and yet the marriage of things that are 19th century, mid-century, very Downton Abbey curtains. On purpose, so that it seemed very boudoirish, but then again, a little bit of edge to make it now. This is a show house I did for Veranda Magazine. It's actually one of my favorite show houses that is probably the most me if I were to walk in someplace. It was also attached to Greystone Mansion, which I'd also like to think was the most me if anyone's ever been there, because everyone thinks it's the most them. Anyone would want it. What our challenge was, everyone was given a room, and you had to give it the purpose they gave it to you for. So my room had to be dual purpose guest bedroom and sort of a pass-through or office room, which I thought, well, that's always ugly, a bed in the corner with a desk. So what I did is I made a sofa that was a full size here, a full size custom sofa that really has a mattress that's just upholstered. So this is a bed, but it really, you can see it looks like a sofa. So when you walk through this room, there's nothing about it where you feel like you're stuck in someone's bedroom. It almost feels like you're in a salon, perhaps sort of a dress salon where you could sit here, but you definitely can sleep. This is definitely a bed that I've disguised in my upholstery, which I think might also be in storage. And once again, I started with the gray, just a simple gray palette, and I paired the smattering of different decades. A modern acrylic table with a sort of fresh and contemporary ceramic lamps, antique chairs, a sort of more modern application of a bed treatment and a sofa, the reproduction antique screen. But the three things that appear very now and clean and modern about this are, I would say, the antique table and instead of using the floor, I did a grayish seagrass here. I used a pattern on the ceiling. I did these big double concentric stripes that added a modern, fresh, young, you know, I like to throw a couple things in that make it more now or just poppy or youthful. I also used these, oh my God, I did it again. Huh, I fixed it. Anyone want to hire me? You should see my office. I can hardly even get from one computer to the other. As Gail was talking about James, who's so sweet, I was like, James is so strict. I don't even know who he was. Like, James is not sweet. James is always fixing our computers, and you know, it's like the big finger. He would be yelling at me for this. So what I, another thing that I find is very contemporary, when you want to make something seem a little more fresh, really overscaled big black and white photographs. And this is my friend Miguel Flores Viana, that has been a magazine editor for years. Now he's an interior photographer, and he gave me these really beautiful overscaled photos. They must be 4 feet by 4 feet of these different glamorous museum shots that are very formal. The subject matter is very formal, but how they have been blown up and put in black and white actually appears very gallery-esque. And all of these things are very inspirational to me. So this is showing my first Schumacher fabric line. And I'm just repeating my love of, if you'll see, I did love that zigzag paper in my closet. It was, you know, it ended up being the birth of an idea for fabric. It wasn't exactly that. My love of big geometric patterns mixed with things that are floral, white, and a two-tone silhouette, and then my love of chinoiserie here for my chinois palette fabric. But if you notice, these all can flow together, also by scale and the actual colors and tonalities that have been put together. And it also has a nice common thread of feminine and with sort of masculine edges tied together with like very soothing colors. This is another sort of glamorous interior. This is the same lady, the lady that produced Frida. And that actually is the original Frida Kahlo self-portrait. It really helped that she was married to a billionaire for all this art. It wasn't from one movie. But I didn't want to eclipse any of her art. So we chose for her living room just various ivories and light grays. Sometimes gray or multiple heavy colors, it will detract from your art. And really this was the what I was given to work with. She had a beautiful fireplace. Oh, what? Oh, it's out of control. She had this Giacometti coffee table. I didn't really want to eclipse any of this. So I once again chose ivory. We did this mid-century inspired sofa, these rather curvaceous, luscious shapes with the little French chairs. And the mid-century inspired chairs here, and actually these stools were something I bought that I ended up putting in my line. I loved them so much that we scaled them up a little bit differently and did all these custom casting, and they were so easy to use. So we did the Jean Royer sconces, but we just kept it very clean. So it was really about the art, but if you really looked at it, each piece had its something of interest. And this is a view towards the other side of the room in just one of the seating groups. Now, she had that Botero, which is very sort of loud, and if anybody, you know, likes Botero, they're very loud and colorful, and it really, I really didn't want to compete with really any of the art, because none of the art actually flowed in any tonal way. So I thought what I want to do is keep this very gallery-esque, yet use enough different furnishings where it feels personal. We have a Ruhlman chair here that's done in a Macassar ebony wood. We have a mid-century chair here. She's very fun and likes things collected. We did the custom Mansour rug here with just a very simple, subtle, linear pattern so that it wasn't too boring. But you'll see it's really sort of an art living room. And lots of these things have inspired. Now this is actually, this isn't really a home. These are some displays from one of my my initial furniture collection that also has a lot of glamour to it. You'll see I I like to use Louis Says pieces a lot. So, you know, I've reproduced this great Louis Says settee that I have in my own home. But if you'll notice, I've married lots of different periods here. I've got this classically based center table that's done in sort of a rough oak finish, with the Maison Janssen inspired all metal chair, with a very playful mid-century French take on the plaster furniture. So I tend to like to marry all these different pieces that are kind of classically based and have been interpreted over the years. These sconces here that have a brass sort of star back are from my Robert Abbey collection. But once again, if anyone has seen what Napoleon's house is like, this pattern is very French, very repeated throughout France, Malmaison, and I'm always drawn to it. But I just find a way to reuse these things either in a home or one of my lines. So I tend to draw from the same thing. And once, oh, wait, no. What? Hold on. What? Okay, wait. So once again, this is another angle of one of my furniture vignettes for Chaddock Home, and I really tried to make it how we set this up and all the pieces I used. This is something I would do for a client. My love of the large geometric pattern on the floor, but cleanly done, not a lot of colors. Although I love color, I'm known for color. I just don't like a lot of different colors all over the place. I like it very well thought out. The classic Clismos legged coffee table. These chests here have a Clismos leg. So I really have a love of classicism. And I love the passementry going down the sofa here. This is something I use for people all the time. And look, here's my stools that I just showed you that I had Margie Parentia buy. And I guess I stole them is what I did right here. I've taken them and reproduced them, but she didn't care at all, so don't worry about it. But I love all these little details that are like jewelry, and that's probably from my love of fashion. So if I can always throw things that have this little special detail in, you know, I'm getting all the parts that I love to have done together for me. This, I think, is my last category, and this is super fun. Sometimes people ask me to do things that are super sort of super indulgent is what I'd like to say. This is a child's playroom. For the poor, poor, poverty-stricken children, obviously. It's what I call my billionaire's charity club. No, actually, this really, I'm not kidding, this really is a playroom. But these people, I've done so many great rooms for them. They've moved a couple times. They have three little girls, and I've done another tent room for them. This I recently completed in the past year or two. And she saw a little piece of pink chinoiserie paper, and she said, I want to do in our new house one of those tent rooms, but I need you to incorporate this paper. And I thought, what do we do? And I thought, well, I can't do the whole room like a tent, so I'll have to actually make it look like it's tented on the roof and just parts of it, the tent are, they're coming down in certain areas. And it's like you're peeping through to, you know, the natural French jungle out there. But once again, we wanted to kind of move in a more modern direction. So we had the floor painted all white, and we had all this custom done paper by DeGournay, and this paper went back and forth for like a year because it wasn't something they made. It came back lavender, it came back weird pink, it came back the ugliest pink I've ever seen in my life, and then we finally got it to be this vibrant sort of borscht soup with a little cream pink, and we made sure that we kept this little teeny bits of navy in here so that we had one spot of a dark color that we could use to just punctuate the room so it wasn't all pink and white like candy. And And here's the room from other angles. Now, you'll notice here we did a custom painted floor by one of our great guys that knows Scott Flax. So he mimicked this very clean modern Greek pattern around the floor, because you really don't need much. If you've got hot pink DeGournay paper, this is real fabric that we've had done on the ceiling. This is actually real nautical rope, because everything else wasn't the right scale. I had to actually go buy authentic nautical rope that was done in knots in the corners here. And sometimes on jobs you intend to do something. We had intended to have these ropes hang with big knots coming down here. But once you get it up there, even for me, sometimes upon installation, something's not working or it looks too junky. And if the client lets me switch midstream, where I'm like, it doesn't look as good as I thought it would. We nixed that. Of course, then there's some clients that go, well, then what's wrong? How did you not know that? And of course I have to go with it, like, of course I know that. I that would never happen. Some people aren't okay with shifts, but I really truly find with creativity there is always an unknown, and when something gets installed, sometimes it doesn't even matter what it said on paper or how it fit. It just doesn't really look the same, and you might want to shift it around. And I think that really honestly go away. Uh-oh, he's mad at me. Okay, well, I don't know what to do with that. So you'll see, looking through the play table on the right here, we had, there's a fireplace in the room. And this room, the purpose of this room is really so that other parents can bring their kids over, and if they want to sit over here and talk and all the kids can play at the table, then they have that opportunity. So it's childlike, and yet at the same time it's sort of fun and adult. I don't know what I did. I'm not very technical. Now, this is her original tent room that we did that was much more soothing and less wacky, and our children were more like little, they were little baby girls. And then on the left, this room was actually much bigger. But this was all faux painted, and she just happened to move into two houses that had these great rooms with these high pitched ceilings. And on the left side of the room, we created this little dress up tent that you'll see. We repeated this little double scallop that we had painted all around the room. And I think this is actually so soothing because we just use white and a pastel. And then if you go back and compare it to this one, which is really the same formula done in different colors, you can see how differently you could create when things are quite different colors. I'm not sure why that's in there. I think that's just wrong. Oh, no, it's not. I remembered. Like I said, not everything is preset on paper, but when I installed this mirror in the closet, that it had all these, it's an antique mirror, and it had all these pretty leaves, but someone broke one off, and then the other was on the floor, and I thought, I'm not fixing that. And I have all these crazy ostrich feathers I love that I have in a vase that sit somewhere in my closet, and a couple of them actually go to these evening dresses. So I put them up there, and I just see it as a whimsical can-can girl thing, and I never took them down because I actually ended up liking it more in a sort of funny French bedroom way than actually seeing what was not broken up there. So be willing to just reinvent yourself as you go. This is a totally different person's house. It's a long loggia on the outside of there. It's a very English house with very primary colors, yellow and black living room and a red dining room. And she said, I want something that's sort of fun and whimsical. So we repeated this very tent-like, striking black and white loggia with just mimicking a tent on the back wall and having the striped cabana portieres on the front, but it created such a playful look, and it really is just made by this and the back wall. Otherwise, it would just be striped and very pretty, but just striped seating arrangements. Oh my God, I have more. Well, I'm just gonna zip through this because now I'm talking too long. So classic is really about just the base of classicism, which is one of the bases of my work. Even if I get all wacko, you might notice the base of pairs, a Greco-Roman influence, things of that nature. You'll usually find them if you pick it apart, even in my furniture line and some of my lamp lines, my rug line. It actually all is based in a very classic way. This was a guy's house I did that was actually a model. And he literally had one chair, and he actually, this is funny, he was kind of this gorgeous, real, famous model guy that dated Paris Hilton for a while, and the only thing he had, which makes me laugh, the only thing, he had this sentimental sofa left over from their great love affair, and it was this thing, but it was fuzzy and part of a contemporary sectional thing, something that it was not cute. So I said, well, we can keep it and turn it into this. So somehow, under there, I've left his love intact. I don't know how, when I look at this and it looks like it's from Ralph Lauren, but it was the base of a contemporary L-shaped sectional sofa that, I don't know, was, you take your half and I'll take mine. So. And then when I upholstered all the walls in gray felt, I did his whole house based on what would Bill do, as in Bill Blass. Because if you think of a masculine home that is so well done, and yet it's not really frilly on any level, but it's really done, and it looks done, I think of anything Bill Blass does. And I loved his home, his New York apartment that Mach 2 had done. So I tried to reference that in my head, because sometimes it's hard doing something for a guy if you actually want it to look completed, where it doesn't end up looking over-decorated. Now, having said that, when I installed this bust in front of the screen with Napoleon looking at him in bed, he goes, "Is that like normal?" And I said, and he said, "I don't know. I mean, this is like kind of like, I don't know, is that kind of like really gay or something? Like, why would I have that?" Because even any of my gay friends wouldn't have that. So I said, no, it's great. Needless to say, I own that Napoleon. Yeah. I tried to tell him this didn't look over-decorated, as if he was like a dude that did it. Anyway, this is part of his living room. You'll notice the 18th century pedestals on just some zinc catalog urns that were kind of fabulous. Sometimes you find these things that they're done so simply and so well in catalogs that you know, it's so easy to pair the high-low these days that there's really no excuse for everyone's bad decorating. We used a 19th century table. I really based everything here on just things that were classic. Oh, we're almost finished here. Oh, goodness, I'm so lost. So if you'll notice, we have an antique table here, the English chairs, these Klismos chairs, which actually I designed for this house, and I ended up using them in my Chaddock line. I love them so much, that were inspired by Bill Blass's house, and they're an antique inspiration from something that went on the auction, up for auction, that was from his home, the Piranesi prints, and we used only men's fabric that would go for suiting. So it was either gray pinstripes. These pillows are from an actual authentic vintage Thai fabrics that a fabric store, an old defunct fabric store, was selling all these men's vintage Thai fabrics, and I bought all the lot of them. And we did so many different things in this house. So his house had a very common thread of masculine elegance. And the reason it's successful is he really just let me do it, because you can really imagine what a guy does to a house when you leave him alone. This is a vignette of one of my Chaddock furniture collections, and you'll see that I've commonly used some of the same threads of classicism. These bookcases of these sort of cylinder and block coining, this sort of classical element, the Klismas sofa, the campaign chair, oh, my stool once again, but with the little jewelry-like feature. And then this is one of my rugs for Patterson, Flynn, and Martin. But you can see how you put things together. They don't necessarily have to be from the same period. It's really all about your vision and how well you can put things together. Because this is actually a very, on one hand, it's a very ethnic type rug. It's made with all natural abaca. And at the same time, if you look at the pattern, it's very directoire. So adding this one element here is still very classical. And keeping your colors clean, if you're not all over the place with multiple colors, it lends itself to a much cleaner contemporary interior. All of these patterns I love. These are all patterns from my Patterson, Flynn, and Martin rug line. But if you just notice throughout, I've used all of these patterns in a similar way, either in wallpaper or my painted seagrass floor, a chinoiserie sort of fretwork Chinese Chippendale vibe, and depending on how you use them and what scale and what color, you don't even need much inspiration. It's really how you execute the things that inspire you and all the different ways you execute it. It creates the diversity in your work or your product. You could be inspired by the same thing your entire life and do it so many different ways every decade. This is the chair again. You'll see I've got this common thread of this love of Klismas, the love of classicism, the love of the goat leg, which is all very Bill Blass. So I've tied some of my residential and commercial projects in with my products. This is a Chaddock, some of my Chaddock pieces. Once again, this is a dining room of one of my clients in Beverly Hills, repeating the clean, overscaled, modern pattern floor, which makes this much more modern. But at the same time, I've got a Russian chandelier, 19th century table, 19th century reproduction French chairs, Charles Fraden, a very English style console. So it's very traditional and yet made very clean and modern with the use of one or two elements that are much more contemporary. This is the living room of the kooky outdoor striped lady, but it also matches, so you go out onto her loggia that's all black and white. And the classicism here is very obvious. I've got pairs of urns on pedestals. I mean, even just a lofty apartment, an urn on a pedestal or a pair of something gives something a sense of balance that your mind just reads. So these everything is very paired in here. It's not that I don't ever do things that are not paired, but it's something I love. I actually love the symmetry of classicism. And on this left side of the room and the right side of the room behind us, there are two L-shaped sofas. So my challenge here was this woman entertains all the time, and it was quite a big living room, but I didn't know how to join all of these. If you had a big, big party, how do you get everybody to talk to each other if they had to? Oh my God, I need to be fired. Okay, I don't know what you just did. Oh, okay. So what I did is when I initially had the assignment, I did a floor plan where the whole room went around this open poof. So these people can sit on it and talk to this person. The people at the fire can pull a chair up and talk to these people. This can create a whole party into itself that can talk to all these groups on all sides of the room. But my love of classicism is very apparent here with my references of even the 18th century French chairs, but the pairs that are evident all over the place. And that, I think, is it. So this is my love of
portieres in references to sort of France and the way that rooms will be partitioned off with sets of curtains. This was my last home, looking from my entry to my living room to my sunroom, and that sort of bright yet at the same time traditional take on a contemporary way to do a traditional interior. So I think, oh, that's it. So thank you all for coming.